Thank you very much for joining us today, and we're very, very pleased to have the team from Slayang to be presenting first a case, followed by some update on what we want to know on the bile acid malabsorption. Option. So please, I'll get Dr. Chan Guanhua to present first, followed by Dr. Tan Kah Chun for this session. Go ahead, Dr. Chan. Are you able to share back your screen, Dr. Chan? We have lost the screen. Go ahead. I can see that very clearly. Thank you. You're still muted. Dr. Chan, can you unmute yourself?
Oh, is it okay now, Prof?
I can hear you now, but you have stopped sharing screen.
Oh, so sorry. What about
Okay,
now?
now, yes, okay, perfect. Thank you.
Okay, sorry for the problem. Thank
No
you.
worries.
So again, thank you, Prof. Rose. Thank you, Project. You will join the call for giving us the opportunity to present the case. We'll be presenting on the dynamic approach to chronic diarrhea with considerations for bile acid malabsorption. With me is my consultant, Dr. Tan Kah Chun. So I'll begin with the case discussion first. So we have a Mr. CTY, a 66 years old gentleman. With underlying a chronic hepatitis B, E antibody is reactive. It's a cirrhotic with a Child's A6. So he's complicated with a hepatocellular carcinoma, which there is a left lateral hepatectomy was done in 2011. And the HPE shows there's a two liver lesion. There's two lesions with a different histological type. One is a hepatocellular carcinoma, and the other one is a moderately differentiated or combined hepatocellular cholangiocarcinoma. So he's on tenofovir 300 mg OD, and the latest viral load is not detected. So otherwise, he's also have a open collar cystectomy for a collar cystitis in 2022, and the HPE of the sample is a chronic cholecystitis and other comorbid including a type 2 diabetes mellitus and a dyslipidemia. So this is a medication list. They have a pravastatin 200 mg on night. He's have a metformin sustained release 1.5 g OD and a subcutaneous mixed start as well as a tenofovir 300 mg daily. So during the follow-up in August 2022, he went to our hepatobiliary clinic follow-up for a surveillance of a post-hemi-hepatectomy or for hepatocellular carcinoma. So during the follow-up, he complained of a diarrhea for the past 1 year, and it occurred actually started 2 to 3 days after the cholecystectomy, and it's happened 2 to 3 episodes per day with a Bristol stool chart of 5 to 7. And usually occur post-meal, especially breakfast, and it's not associated with any specific food intake. Otherwise, there's no fever, there's no abdominal pain, there's no constitutional symptom, there's no weight loss, there's no loss of appetite, there's no PR bleeding as well, and the physical examination is normal. Pre-abdomen, there's no mass palpable, and there's no goiter.
So, thank you, Dr. Chan, for the clinical history. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Tan Kah Chun from Hospital Selayang. So, before we proceed, let's look at what is the definition of chronic diarrhea. So, diarrhea can be defined in terms of the stool consistency, frequency, volume, and weight. And patient concern of the diarrhea of always focus on the stool consistency. And indeed, the stool consistency is determined by the water holding capacity of the stool. Perhaps this best defines the concept of diarrhea. However, quantification of this is difficult in clinical ground. Therefore, utility of the Bristol stool chart is recommended, and anything a stool more than Bristol 5 is considered as diarrhea. So today, There's no consensus on the duration of the diarrhea to differentiate the chronic or the acute diarrhea. However, most of the guidelines accepting that patient with persistent symptoms of more than 4 weeks is associated with non-infective cause of diarrhea, and therefore they require further investigation. Therefore, a pragmatic definition incorporates these elements. Chronic diarrhea is the persistent alteration from the norm with stool consistency between types 5 and 7 on the Bristol stool chart, and increased frequency greater than 4 weeks duration. So I believe that most of the time when we receive the referral from the periphery, we get a simple history and normal investigation for the chronic diarrhea. So sometimes it is very frustrated because there's incomplete information to get the diagnosis of the chronic diarrhea. Therefore, BSG guidelines recommend a careful detailed history to plan the investigation and to reach the diagnosis of chronic diarrhea. The clinical history should include the following: family history of colon cancer, inflammatory bowel disease and the celiac disease. Previous surgeries such as ileal resection and the cholecystectomy are associated with bowel acid malabsorption. Certain bariatric surgery may lead to small intestinal bacteria overgrowth. And patients with steatorrhea, it is important to ask about the previous pancreatic history. Systemic diseases such as thyrotoxicosis, hypoparathyroidism, diabetes, adrenal disease, or the systemic sclerosis can also cause chronic diarrhea because of the endocrinological effect, the autonomic dysfunction, as well as the small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. Apart from that, chronic alcohol consumption can also lead to diarrhea. The mechanism can be due to the direct toxin injury to the intestinal mucosa, increase in the gastrointestinal motility, as well as decrease the pancreatic function. Diet history is very important because lactase deficiency and lactose intolerance is actually not uncommon in Asian populations. Drug history always be missed during the clinical history taking apart, but actually up to 4% of the cases, particularly magnesium supplements, ACE inhibitors, NSAID, DPP-4 inhibitors, theophylline, antibiotics, antiarrhythmia, and certain antineoplastic agents are associated with chronic diarrhea. We should also ask about patients about recent overseas travel because traveler diarrhea can cause chronic diarrhea. Recent antibiotic use can lead to Clostridium difficile infection and eventually leads to diarrhea also. So now, come back to the case again.
Thank you, Dr. Tan, for enlightening us on the history taking and its importance. So back to the case. So a set of blood has been taken for the current follow-up, which is for the hepatoma surveillance. So we have a white cell count of 6, a hemoglobin of 15, platelet of 452, AST ALT is around 20+, bilirubin is 16, urea 3, creatinine 59, INA is 1.07, alpha-fetal protein is 3.3, and the happy viral load is not detected, is suppressed on a 10 or 4 way. So there's ultrasound done as well. There's no recurrence, there's no focal liver lesion C. It's fatty liver and there's a prostatomegaly. As far as the recent CT liver also, it shows similar findings with no CT evidence of new liver lesion. There's a non-obstructive right renal calculi and a prostatomegaly. So note that during our colleague follow-up, history is very brief. And your colonoscopy was immediately ordered 1 week later. And it was scoped until terminal ileum, and it was normal endoscopically. There's no biopsy taken in this colonoscopy. He was then referred back to a hepatology to follow up.
Thanks for the history again. So apart from the detailed clinical history, in the patient with chronic diarrhea, BSG also recommend to do some basic blood tests during the primary clinical assessment to exclude anemia, inflammation, thyroid disease, as well as celiac disease in certain region, and stool tests to look for Clostridium difficile infection, ova and cyst, and parasite. So in my clinical experience, Most of the patients with chronic diarrhea will have a colonoscopy. We undergo a colonoscopy. However, what is the role of colonoscopy and what is the diagnostic view of colonoscopy in the patient with chronic diarrhea? Several studies have examined the diagnostic view of colonoscopy in the evaluation of chronic diarrhea, with the specific diagnosis only found in 15 to 31% of the patient, and mainly are the inflammatory bowel disease and the microscopic colitis. I do not deny that for patients with altered bowel habit and the lower gastrointestinal bleeding required a colonoscopy. However, apart from these diagnoses, it is important to think twice whether we need to subject this patient for this invasive procedure. So we will go back to the history again.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Tan, again. So during a hepatologic clinic follow-up in September 2022, on further questioning, actually the patient still having a loose two episodes per day. It was Bristol 5 to 7, and it occurred right after the post-cholecystectomy, 2 to 3 days after the cholecystectomy. Usually it occurred post-meal, especially after breakfast. Otherwise, there's no reflex, there's no abdominal pain, there's no PR bleeding, there's no loss of weight. And we also try to ask that what Dr. Tan emphasized on the history is very important. So there are some history elicited. So patient did not any family history of a GI malignancies. Clinically, it's euthyroid. There's no hyperthyroid symptoms. And but the glycemic control, especially if a diabetes mellitus, is on subcutaneous mixture as well as a metformin, a sustained release. The fasting blood sugar is still on the high side, is 13, with an HbA1c of 7.5. He's under our endocrine colleague follow-up as well. There's no reason self-monitoring of blood glucose at home. There's no reason change for the medication. He's remain on a pravastatin, metformin, mixture as well as 10 or 4 way. Otherwise, he denies any alcohol consumption. For diet-wise, he took about, in the breakfast, usually he took a half-boiled eggs, some toast and a tea and coffee. There's no like a lot of, he's not like taking a lot of caffeine consumption as well. Lunch, usually take a small portion of rice or noodle with some dishes or vegetables and some meat. Otherwise, there's also no reason travel to suggest any infectious causes, or there's not any reason antibiotic use or hospitalization as well. So, you know, the chronic diarrhea happened for almost 2 years already post-cholecystectomy. A set of investigation was ordered, which include a thyroid function test. 3D4 is 13.1 within range. TSH is normal as well, 1.1. Serum serology was sent as well with anti-deaminated gliadin, anti-tissue transglutaminase, and anti-entomizer antibodies are all negative. Alpha fetal protein was done for hepatoma surveillance, which is 3.4 normal, and CEA also is not raised, 4.1. Otherwise, C-reactive protein is less than 5. HIV also was screened and was non-reactive. We took some stool investigation as well, including stool culture, stool ova and cyst, and also C diff, which are all negative. So, then, actually, with the significant history of a cholecystectomy, the symptoms started after the cholecystectomy, we are strongly thinking of a bowel acid diarrhea. We initially plan to do a CCAT test, but in view of a resource limitation, we decided to give a trial of a cholestyramine, which is a bowel acid sequestrant, of a 4 gram OD for 3 days, and subsequently a follow up with the patient, and he informed that the diarrhea actually improved drastically after the cholestyramine. And however, the diarrhea recurred 1 day right after stopping the cholestyramine. So we concluded that we want to treat this patient as a bowel acid malabsorption, and he was maintained on the cholestyramine 4 gram daily. So subsequent follow-up in the recent follow-up in February this year, so patient claimed that for the past 1 month, the symptoms of a diarrhea actually recurred. If a passing out loose 2 or 3 times per day, and usually after breakfast. Upon further history, patient claimed that he wasn't very compliant to the cholestyramine, largely because of the unpalatable taste, which it tastes like resin. And sometimes, and the symptoms was not very bad, so he defaulted the cholestyramine. But otherwise, there's no other abdominal pain, there's no reflex. And so patient was advised for compliance to cholestyramine with a consideration to titrate up the cholestyramine up to 8 grams if the symptoms still persist despite compliance. At this time also, we actually found out that Hospital Kuala Lumpur, actually HKL, it have a CCAT test available. And thus, we have arranged a CCAT test for the patient. And also, we for another repeat a colonoscopy to rule out microscopic colitis. So a colonoscopy was done. It was scoped until a terminal ileum. Endoscopically, the mucosa and the vasculature appears to be normal. We have taken some segmental random biopsies to rule out microscopic colitis, which the HPE come back within normal limits, and there's no features to suggest a microscopic colitis. And we also follow up for the CCAT test, which shows only a 0.5% of a tracer retention in the abdomen at the day 7. This signifies that there are scintigraphic evidence of a severe bowel acid malabsorption, which is less than 5%. Later we'll explain more on this test. So with that, we concluded that this patient having a severe bowel acid diarrhea or malabsorption, and it was maintained on a cholestyramine 4 gram daily. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Chan, for the clinical history. So now, this patient was diagnosed to have bowel acid diarrhea based on the CCAT test. And bowel acid diarrhea also can be known as the bowel acid malabsorption or the bowel salt malabsorption, although these are not the correct terminology. So let's delve into what bowel acid diarrhea is. I believe that after some blood investigation and also colonoscopy, we show a normal investigation in a patient with chronic diarrhea. Some of us may diagnose the patient as the irritable bowel syndrome. And I do not deny that some of these patients fulfill the diagnostic criteria for irritable bowel syndrome. So let's see what is the definition of room 4 criteria for IBS. It defines the patient as recurrent abdominal pain on average at least 1 day per week in the last 3 months, associated with 2 or more of the following criteria, which are related to the defecation, associated with a change in the frequency of stool, and associated with a change in the form of stool. And the criteria fulfilled for the last 3 months with the symptom onset at least 6 months prior to the diagnosis. Now, the question is, what if your patient doesn't really have irritable bowel syndrome? And I found this paper. This paper is quite old. At the time, they're using the Room 2 criteria to diagnose the irritable bowel syndrome. But at the time, they found that out of 66 patients with irritable bowel syndrome, 14 actually had celiac disease based on the investigation. This is the more recent study done by the Red Lake et al. And the author concluded that about 1/3 of the patient or 32% of the patient with the functional diarrhea or the irritable bowel syndrome with predominant diarrhea actually has bowel acid diarrhea confirmed from the CCAT testing. So therefore, bowel acid diarrhea is a common but frequently under-investigated cause of chronic diarrhea, with the prevalence estimated prevalence of about 1% of the general population. Next, we look at the pathophysiology of bowel acid diarrhea. Primary bowel acid is the cholic acid and the chinodeoxycholic acid, and there are synthesis in the liver from the cholesterol by the means of the cholesterol 7-alpha hydroxylase. After that, they will be conjugated with the amino acid, the glycine and choline, and stored in the gallbladder. Following a meal, this will be released into the gastrointestinal tract and facilitate the absorption of the fat and the fat-soluble vitamin. About 95% of the primary bowel acid will be reabsorbed in the terminal ileum and returned to the liver via the porta system. Only less than 5% of the primary bowel acid will be excreted into the colon. And when the primary bowel acid exposed to the gut bacteria, they will undergo the dehydroxylation and form the secondary bile acid, which are the lytocholic acid and the deoxycholic acid. When there is excessive secondary bile acid in the colon, this will lead to the abnormal water and the sodium transport. After that, it will lead to increase the gastrointestinal mortality, mucosa damage, increased mucus secretion, and eventually stimulation of the defecation, and leads to the sign and symptoms of bile acid diarrhea. So for your information, bile acid usually synthesis in the liver around 0.5 gram per day. After that, the bile acid pool of 3 to 5 gram is recycled about 4 to 12 times per day. Only 5% of the bile acid will be lost in the feces every day, about 0.2 to 0.6 gram. So the synthesis of the bile acid also controlled by this negative feedback loop. The bile acid, as mentioned just now, the bile acid in the terminal ileum are absorbed via the apical sodium-dependent bile acid transporter to activate the ileal thymusoid X receptor, which induces the transcription of fibroblast growth factor 19. This is then released into the porta circulation and travel to the liver to activate the hepatic thymusoid X receptor, which act on the cholesterol 7-alpha hydroxylase via the short heterodimer primer, thus decreasing the bile acid synthesis. The fibroblast growth factor 19 also binds to the fibroblast growth factor receptor 4 in the hepatocytes, which interact with the beta-chloto to inhibit the cholesterol 7-alpha hydroxylase, leading to further decrease in the bile acid synthesis via the classical pathway and activating the hepatocyte thymusoid X receptor. Production of the fibroblast growth factor 19 therefore inhibits the bile acid synthesis by these two negative feedback loops. So by listening to the pathophysiology of the bile acid diarrhea, let's see the classification of the bile acid diarrhea. It basically can be classified into three types. Type one is basically due to the ileal dysfunction, and this impacts the reabsorption of the bile acid. The diseases can cause this bile acid diarrhea are Crohn disease, ileal resection, and the radiation enteropathy. For the patient with the Crohn disease without the ileal resection, the prevalence of the bile acid malabsorption ranges from 11% to 76%, but this significantly raised to more than 90% in the patient with Crohn disease with resected ileum. However, what is the relationship between the length of the resection and bile acid malabsorption is still unclear, but one study showed that there is a significantly higher serum C4 level in the Crohn disease patient with resection of more than 70%. Type 2 bile acid diarrhea is also known as idiopathic bile acid diarrhea. Clinically, it is manifested as functional diarrhea or irritable bowel syndrome with predominant diarrhea. Clinically, there's no defect in the bile acid absorption, and the putative mechanism of this type 2 bile acid diarrhea is hepatic overproduction of the bile acid and an impaired feedback by the fibroblast growth factor 19. For type 3, it is due to the other gastrointestinal disorder, which is not associated with the ileal dysfunction. For example, biliopancreatic diseases, celiac disease, microscopic colitis, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, and the cholecystectomy. In this patient, is typically post-cholecystectomy bile acid diarrhea. And for the patient with the celiac disease, the pathophysiology can be due to the villus atrophy, and there is inflammation of the gallbladder and small bowel motor dysfunction. Similarly to the microscopic colitis, there's also villus atrophy and also collagen deposition in the small bowel that leads to abnormal reabsorption of the bile acid. So how do we diagnose a bile acid diarrhea? I will talk about the CCAT test in detail in the subsequent slides. So the other test I think it's basically not available in my hospital. So C4 basically is the precursor of the bile acid synthesis, which is the 7-alpha-hydroxy-4-cholesterol-3-1. So it is a marker of the bile acid synthesis. At baseline, the fasting C4 level will be a rise in the patient with a bile acid diarrhea. And there is impaired negative feedback to the fibroblast growth factor 19. It has a negative feedback with negative predictive value of 98%, making it a very good test to exclude the bile acid diarrhea. So the other test is the fasting serum fibroblast growth factor 19. The level of the fibroblast growth factor 19 will be inversely compared to the level of C4. That means in the bile acid diarrhea, the C4 level will be high, but the fibroblast growth factor 19 will be low. So if you do not have the CCAT test to diagnose bile acid diarrhea, we also can use the fecal test to test the fecal bile acid. Basically, the test is to test the total amount of the bile acid that is excreted into the colon. And the number of to diagnose bile acid diarrhea is 2,337 micromole over 48 hours. So next, I will talk about the CCAT test. I'm proudly inform you that in Hospital Kuala Lumpur, we are offering this test by the Department of Nuclear Medicine. And this test is mainly done by Dr. Muhammad Fazlin. And this is the CCAT capsule. If you suspected your patient to have bile acid diarrhea, you may discuss with Dr. Fazlin to order this CCAT capsule from United Kingdom. And it will take about 3 to 4 weeks to come to Hospital Kuala Lumpur, and the cost is about 3,500 ringgit Malaysia. So pregnancy is an absolute contraindication for CCAT test, and those with lactating and breastfeeding mother are relative contraindication to do this test. Patient need to fast for 4 hours, and certain medications such as the bile acid sequestrants and the anti-diarrhea should be stopped for at least 1 week. These are the drugs. These pictures show the drugs that you need to stop before performing the CCAT test. So basically, the capsule is the radio label synthetic conjugated bile acid, and patients need to ingest the capsule after an overnight fast, and a standard gamma camera will be performed 3 hours after the ingestion to look at the baseline tracer level. So after that, the similar gamma camera will be performed at day 7 to look for the retention of the tracer. The normal range is usually more than 15%, but for those who have less than 15%, for those who have a 10 to 15%, it will be classified as mild bile acid diarrhea. 5 to 10% is moderate, and less than 5% will be classified as severe bile acid diarrhea. So how about the trial of bile acid sequestrant in the diagnosis of bile acid diarrhea? Like in our case, we do not have the CCAT test initially. So we empirically give the patient a bile acid sequestrant, and the patient improved, and the patient's symptoms improved drastically. So what does BSG say? In a series of 264 patients, where 53% had bile acid diarrhea and 44% failed to respond to the cholestyramine alone, and half of these non-responders derive benefit from the cholestyramine, thus, lack of the response to cholestyramine does not constitute the exclusion of bile acid diarrhea. So, therapeutic trial of bile acid sequestrants with the cholestyramine or cholestyramine are not recommended to make the diagnosis of bile acid diarrhea. So after the diagnosis of bile acid diarrhea, what can we do to the patient? As mentioned just now, bile acid facilitates the absorption of the fat and the fat-soluble vitamin. So we can provide the patient low-fat diet with less than 20% of daily energy intake provided from the fat. And on top of that, we give the patient bowel acid secretions. This significantly improved the gastrointestinal symptoms of bowel acid diarrhea, such as the abdominal pain, nocturnal defecation, urgency, flatulence, and the stool consistency and the frequency. So these are the three types of bowel acid secretions that we have: cholesteramine, cholestipol, and cholecervelum. I look into the KKM list. In my hospital, we only have cholesteramine, and the other two are not available in the KKM list. So the cholesteramine is available in the powder form in my hospital. And these are the molecules are positively charged non-digestible resin, which bind the bowel acid in the intestinal lumen, forming an insoluble complex that is eliminated in stool. And by giving this, it significantly improves the abdominal symptoms, stool frequency, and the consistency of the patient with bowel acid diarrhea. Basically, cholesteramine is the most widely used bowel acid secretions. And according to Wetlick et al., from the 15 studies, the CCAT test not only able to diagnose the bowel acid diarrhea, it also able to predict the dose-response relationship between the severity of bowel absorption and the effect of treatment with the bowel acid secretions. The clinical response to the cholesteramine occur in about 96% of the patient for those with severe bowel acid diarrhea. For patients with mild to moderate bowel acid diarrhea, the clinical response to the cholesteramine about 80% and 70% respectively. So the problem of the cholesteramine, I think, is the compliance issue because of the texture and also the taste of the cholesteramine. Other side effects of the cholesteramine are transient hypertriglyceridemia, and it may also interfere with the intestinal absorption of certain drugs. If your patient is given this list of drugs, it is important to advise the patient to take this drug 1 hour before or four hours after the cholesteramine. The high doses of cholesteramine greater than 32 grams per day also associated with malabsorption of the fat-soluble vitamin. And osteomalacia also reported in the patient who are on cholesteramine. Cholecervelum is not available in my hospital. It is a water-soluble polymer with a binding affinity to the bowel acid, which is 4 to 6 times stronger than the cholesteramine. And patient has a higher compliance due to the low incidence of side effects and fewer clinical interaction. So nowadays, we always talk about the prebiotic, probiotic in the treatment of chronic diarrhea. So how about the microbiota modulation in the patient with bowel acid diarrhea? So far, there's no definitive data in the microbiota in the treatment of bowel acid diarrhea. So further research may need to be done. And I think this is my last slide. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tan and Dr. Chan, for the very interesting. And I think I really like the style that you actually had the cases in with explanation along the symptoms as you go along. So I think I have one question for you while waiting for a question for others. Is that, you know, sure. Chronic diarrhea, as you say, is very common. And I think a lot more of us would tend to, once we actually have done a colonoscopy, we tend to actually label this as irritable bowel and in the most cases. So maybe the most important thing to really highlight to us is that, so this person at least had a cholecystectomy and had symptoms immediately after. So at least you actually possibly find the association with the cholecystectomy as a possible cause of bile acid malabsorption. So for others with no history of cholecystectomy and nothing to suggest there's a trigger, what are the typical symptoms that you may want to suggest may be more likely due to bile acid malabsorption in a patient presenting with chronic diarrhea and normal colonoscopy?
Thank you, Prof. Rose, for the questions. Actually, it is difficult to differentiate the irritable bowel syndrome compared to the bowel acid diarrhea, because in the patient with bowel acid diarrhea, it can fulfill the criteria of the irritable bowel syndrome, which can have the recurrent abdominal pain associated with the defecation and change in the stool frequency and the form of the stool. However, actually from the BSG guideline, for the patient with the functional diarrhea or the irritable bowel syndrome predominant diarrhea, they actually suggest to test for the bowel acid diarrhea by using the CCAT test or the C4 level. But whether this test is cost effective and whether it's suitable in our clinical setting, it still need to be considered. But I think in our setting, is the CCAT test is considered as expensive because it's 3,500, and I don't think every patient is affordable to do that.
The patient has to pay for it.
I like the idea that you actually give a trial of cholestyramine as a test, but I think what you also highlighted that if it's not working, it doesn't exclude it at all.
Yes. Actually, I think if you do not have the CCAT test, in my opinion, maybe this is a bit out of the guideline, I think it is worth it to try the bowel acid secretion, particularly in the patient with the cholecystectomy or Crohn's disease, or the patient with suspected after radiation radiotherapy. So if you suspect a bowel acid diarrhea, then you may try this bowel acid secretion before subject this patient for the CCAT test.
And again, highlight to us, the C4 test, it is useful as well, is it? The serum
yes.
C4 test?
Yes, the serum C4 test basically is a precursor of the bowel acid synthesis. And in the bowel acid diarrhea, it will be raised because of impaired feedback of the fibroblast growth factor 19. And it is good to exclude the bowel acid diarrhea because the negative predictive value is 98%.
Ah, so it is quite high.
Yes, it is high. But I'm not sure whether HUKM provided this test, but in Hospital Selayang, we do not have this test.
Okay, I'm not sure either. So perhaps someone else can highlight the availability, whether they actually do have it. Okay, so I think any questions, you can either unmute yourself or you can also put in the chat. But I also have another question while waiting. So this person had ACC and with underlying chronic hepatitis B, and I presume that this was picked up by surveillance ultrasound.
Yes.
So this is what we need to highlight. I think the cost of the treatment that the person had made it possible because of the early detection of the ACC. I see Dr. Tan also. Was that your patient, Dr. Tan?
Prof. Rose, actually, yes. this patient is very lucky because we in Hospital Selayang, we're doing all HCC surveillance for the hepatitis B patient.
Right.
And this patient detected early and able to do the hepatectomy in 2011. Until now, we still proceed with the HCC surveillance every 6 months, and there's no recurrence of the HCC in this patient.
Right, and the person remained to be in child UA, which is very early. And I think that's one of the beauty about hepatitis B related ACC. You still can cause the viral replication and stop the progression of the liver disease as well. And I think we forget sometimes the role of secondary prevention, or sorry, tertiary prevention in patients who had undergone curative treatment for the HCC, antiviral treatment still plays a very big role in tertiary prevention of recurrence of HCC. So I think that is something that we need to highlight. Anything to add, Dr. Tan, from that perspective? Go ahead.
Yeah, so the other thing that's very important to advise a patient is to stop smoking and also ethanol. Some of them still drink and they still smoke, and that will increase the risk. About this patient, I think we share our patient in the clinic, depends on whose luck pick up the card. So I think I have to thank Dr. Tan Ka Chun for looking into diarrhea. He always advised us that diarrhea doesn't mean another colonoscopy and then another colonoscopy, multiple colonoscopy. That's something that we can help the patient with. And thank you for the expert care of this patient, Ka Chun.
Thank you, Professor Rose and Dr. Tan, for the input.
Okay. So the other thing possibly, the cholestyramine, and just to have a bit of a feel, because not many have experience with using cholestyramine. Your starting dose would be quite much the same, regardless of the symptoms.
I also do not have a much experience in starting the cholestyramine, but I see from the studies, they usually study 8 grams per day. So perhaps this patient, we should increase to 4 grams BD, make it 8 grams per day to optimize the symptoms.
Yeah, because I think if you do not optimize the dose, it's something that I have learned that that's why it may not work, because some people are just using a very small dose and this may not work. So I think that is something to pick up. Anything else, anyone?
Professor, actually, there's a question in the chat box.
Ah, okay. I didn't see that. Okay, please go ahead.
The question was, what happens to the bowel acid post cholecystectomy? So actually, after cholecystectomy, the liver will still continue to synthesize the bowel acid, but just it does not have a place to store, and it will be continuously released into the small intestine. And most of the time, our patient will be adapt with this continuous production of the bowel acid. But some minority of the patient may have persistent indigestion symptoms, or the bloatedness, or the bowel acid or diarrhea symptoms. So in this group of patients, we might need to give the treatment to solve the diarrhea. So there's another question here, which is the any role of the UDCA. So I think in short, I think the answer is yes, but I do not have the clinical experience in using the UDCA in the treatment of bowel acid diarrhea. So it's something about the funosoid X receptor inhibitors there. So I'm not sure other people has experience in using UDCA in the treatment of bowel acid diarrhea.
Actually, I did not find studies to suggest that role though. I mean, you think that it may work, but if you look at studies, there aren't any. And actually, I think one of the things you highlight is very good to have this presentation, because it's only now that I found out that up to 30% of people with chronic diarrhea, which are labeled to have irritable bowel, may actually have bile acid malabsorption. So it is very high, and it's high time that we look for it, because it's very much underdiagnosed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, UDCA can cause diarrhea, so I don't know how it will work.
Yes, I think so too. Because I don't think that the similar role, because I think that UDCA, the circumstances that we use are not in this, the bile acid, the cholestyramine here that we are using for pruritus is because it actually do help in a different way. So this is the role of the cholestyramine, bile acid strength, because I'm reading what is written here, that they are positively charged and they bind to the negatively charged bile acids in the intestine and preventing them from breaking down to be absorbed. So I don't think UDCA will have a role because they don't have this function. And that's the main reason why the binding prevents the bile acids from acting in the colon to trigger diarrhea. And that's how the symptoms are reduced. So I think from the physiology or the way it works, UDCA will not be so helpful. Will not be helpful.
Sorry, Prof. Rose, I think I remember wrongly. It's actually it's the obeticholic acid rather than the UDCA.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
And the other interesting point is this, we always been taught like if they're on metformin, blame metformin. This patient is on metformin.
Right. But it's a different kind of diarrhea also, right? That you actually get with metformin. Dr. Tan, what is your experience? In fact, very few people that we do see with metformin induced the diarrhea.
Okay,
so if there's no other questions, thank you very much, everyone. And we look forward to see you next week. We will have the team from UITM with the presentation, our blast the information. We will have it on the 20th of June for next week. Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Tan. That's very helpful. And also Dr. Chan for the case presentation. And also Dr. Tan Siang for actually giving your feedback here. And also suggesting Dr. Tan Ka Chun to be the main presenter for today. Thank you, everyone. We look forward to see you next week. Thank you again.